We have all probably heard the quote and the old quote, knowledge is power. The quote is extremely important to the point where it has become beyond our imagination. Few people understand how knowledge can be so important. Knowledge is what allows us to drive instead of riding horses, and it helps us survive far longer than we could or should. And knowledge is even what prevents us from doing the same mistakes we used to do in the past and learn from them how to grow as individuals. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another episode of The Ocean of Knowledge with me, your host Ahmad Ali. Sayid Hussein Al-Qazwini is joining us tonight to shed some light upon the life of Imam Muhammad Al-Baqir before his Imamah. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Alaykum as-salam.
How are you?
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
Allah salamkum, inshaAllah. Now, I would like to congratulate you as well as congratulate our dear viewers, the Imam of Ahlul-Bait and our pious scholars on the auspicious occasion, which marks the birth anniversary of Imam Muhammad Al-Baqir. Peace and blessings be upon him. Sayyidina, now, some rearrangements happened. Yesterday, we talked about the life of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, and we left off at his worship. You know, growing up, you know, for approximately 38 years under the guidance of his father, Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, you know, a father holding the title Zain al-Abideen is, you know, just that title alone gives a full description of that individual, who he was. Now, what did Imam Al-Baqir learn from his father? What were some of the stuff that he picked up, the qualities, the merits, the characteristics he picked up along the way, you know, from being nurtured from his father?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى الطيبين الطاهرين. Imam Al-Baqir's father was Imam Zain al-Abidin, Ali ibn al-Husayn.
Yes.
Known for his worship,
yeah.
Known for his piety, known for his long nights spent in prayers and in dua and in sujood and all that. Mm-hmm. When we look at the life of Imam Al-Baqir, we see that he's a copy of his father, Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam. He inherited those exact qualities. As we mentioned yesterday, right before we finished, that Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam would pray 150 rak'at every day.
Wow.
Every day. That's in addition to his...
17 mandatory.
That's in addition to the 17 mandatory rak'at, and that's in addition to his, you know, academic responsibilities, his social responsibilities as an imam.
How do you make time for that?
You know, today we hear people saying, I don't have time for this, I don't have time for that. I, for one, I'm a person that always says, I don't have time for this, I don't have time for that. Apparently, Imam Al-Baqir would make time.
Well,
you know, sometimes we're very comfortable with saying the word, I don't have time. But we do. We do. But we choose not to make time.
Mm-hmm.
Imam Al-Baqir chose to make time for worship,
mm-hmm.
to teach, to socialize, to visit friends, to visit believers, to take care of the Shia. He had time for all of them because he made time.
Mm-hmm.
It's about making time. Another quality we see in Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam that he inherited from his father, Imam Zain al-Abidin, was his sujood.
Yes.
His sujood.
Long prostrations.
Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam was known for the beautiful supplications in his sujood. For example, Ishaq ibn Ammar,
yes.
a companion of Imam Al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he narrates from Imam Al-Sadiq. He says that one night I was preparing the bed for my father.
Mm-hmm.
You know, putting it on the ground, preparing it. Because back then, they didn't have different rooms in the house. There's a bedroom, there's a dining room, there's a living room. No, it was all one room. Our imams lived in one room. That room was their bedroom at night. In the morning, it was their dining room. During the day, it was their living room and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So he said, I was preparing his bed, but my father was nowhere to be found. He said, I went and I looked for him in the masjid. And I saw that he was performing sujood. No, there was no one inside the masjid. The masjid was empty except my except my father. He said, I noticed he was performing sujood and he was reciting, Subhanaka Allahumma, Anta Rabbi haqqan haqqa, glory to you, my Lord. You are my Lord, you are my God. In truth, سَجَدْتُ لَكَ يَا رَبِّي تَعَبُّدًا وَرَقًا. I prostrate to you out of servitude. اللهم إن عملي ضعيف فضاعفه لي.
Wow.
My Lord, my actions are weak. Multiply them for me. Make them stronger. اللهم قني عذابك يوم تبعث عبادك. Oh Allah, let me, you know, avoid your punishment on the day that you will resurrect
your servants.
This is
the Imam, though.
This is the Imam.
You know, from the history that we learn and from traditions, Imam, they're the ones that, you know, intercede for the people who are going to hell.
Right.
Now they're saying, oh Allah, avoid us being punished?
See, first of all, Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, they were sinless. So this is a general issue.
To teach that, us?
Well, this is one, to teach us, to teach their companions how to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
He was alone though.
Right. This is one reason. Mm-hmm. And another reason, you see, there might be a behavior, mm-hmm. an act. For a regular person like us, we think it's a good deed. Mm-hmm. But for the Ahlul Bayt, they would be embarrassed of it.
Wow.
I'll give you an example. For example, if we were to pray Salat al-Layl every night, this is excellent. If Allah gave us the opportunity to pray Salat al-Layl every night, that is incredible. And our Salah would take maybe 30 minutes. That's incredible. But for a person like Imam Al-Baqir to pray Salat al-Layl for 30 minutes at night, that's like committing a sin. That's something ugly. That's that's something to be ashamed of. You would seek forgiveness for Allah for praying Salat al-Layl for 30 minutes.
Wow.
You see, something that we would consider a good deed for the Ahlul Bayt, they would consider a sin. They would consider a misdemeanor or, you know, disrespectful to Allah Azza wa Jalla. So that's another possible reason. Yeah. That Imam Baqir is seeking forgiveness for his shortcomings. Although we would consider them to be pious deeds. But for him, why? Why would he consider them? Do we consider them pious deeds, but the Imam doesn't?
Mm-hmm.
Because the Imam is saying that these deeds are being done for Allah.
Yes.
We tend to neglect that. We tend to neglect that who's on the receiving end. Who are we performing these deeds towards? If it's Allah,
yes.
we usually don't pay attention.
Mm-hmm.
So we think that we've done a great deed. But the Imam is realizing that these deeds are for Allah. Anything that we do for Allah, it's still little. As Imam Zain Abidin alayhi salam says in Dua Abu Hamza al-Thamali, وَمَا قَدْرُ أَعْمَالِنَا بِجَنْبِي نَعْمِكِ.
Wow.
Well, if I do good deeds from morning till night and from night till morning, they're meaningless towards what Allah has provided us and done for us. وَمَا قَدْرُ أَعْمَالِنَا بِجَنْبِي نَعْمِكِ وَكَيْفَ نَسْتَكْثَرُ أَعْمَالًا نُقَابِلُ بِهَا كَرَمِكِ. And how can we say that I've done this and I've done that? When whom? When on the other side we have Allah that's given us so much. How can we assume that we've done? The Ahlul Bayt, they don't have this mentality. They have the mentality that whatever they've done, it's still not enough.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, for someone to actually hear such things, for Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, they make us seem like we're not even worshippers.
Right.
We're not even compared to the amount they worship.
Right.
But shifting back a bit, you know, 38, 36, or somewhat, Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam is distinguished from the rest of the Imams,
right,
in an idea that both of his grandfathers are infallible. I want to talk about his parents. Now, on one side, his grandfather is Imam Al-Hasan alayhi salam, and on the other side, his grandfather is Imam Al-Husayn. Now, we don't see this from the rest of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Random, you know, they're not random, but you know, they're chosen to be the mothers for the Imam. Who were the parents of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam?
Ahsant. Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, as you mentioned, his father was Imam Zain Abidin, the son of Imam Al-Husayn, the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib.
Yes.
From his mother's side, his mother was the daughter of Imam Al-Hasan, Sayyidah Zakiya Fatima,
mm-hmm.
Mati Imam Al-Hasan. Fatima, the daughter of Imam Al-Hasan, was his mother. Thus, both Imam al-Hussein and Imam al-Hassan were his
grandfathers.
One paternally, the other was maternally. We all know about Imam Zain al-Abidin.
Yes.
As for his mother, historians say that she was the best daughter after, out of the daughters of Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam. And Imam Zain al-Abidin, Imam Zain al-Abidin would call her As-Siddiqah.
Yes.
She was his wife. He would call her As-Siddiqah. This is a title given to
Fatima
al-Zahra alayhi salam. This was a great title.
She had the same name as her grandmother, correct?
She had the same grand. Yeah, she had the same name and the same title. Ahsant. And Imam al-Sadiq had stated regarding her, كانت صديقة لم تدرك في آل الحسن مثلها.
Wow.
Imam Sadiq would call her Siddiqa. He would not call her Fatima. يعني the title was like a name to her. He said, from the children of Imam al-Hassan, there was none like her. A father like this and a mother like this, you would expect
the result,
a son like
Al-Baqir,
Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. Regarding his birth, you know, right now we're celebrating his birth on the first of
Rajab.
The first of Rajab. This is according to one narration.
Mm-hmm.
According to one narration that he was born on the first of Rajab.
Another one.
On Friday, year 57.
Mm-hmm.
And another narration says that he was born
in Safar.
In Safar, Ahsan.
Second?
Third.
Third.
Third of Safar, year 56. Year 56. Third of Safar, year 56. Another narration says the first of Rajab, year 57. Seven. And this is the more popular narration.
Yes.
In, you know, in one of the du'as of Rajab that we recite, that is highly recommended to recite. Of course, the month of Rajab is a blessed month.
Very blessed.
It's a highly spiritual month, and there is several du'as and supplications to be recited on a daily basis. One of them is this: Allahumma inni as'aluka bil mawludaini fi Rajab.
Wow.
Muhammad ibn Ali, who is Imam al-Baqir, and Imam al-Jawad. They are both mentioned in the beginning of the dua. And this is a well-known dua that all scholars have accepted. So this is the more popular narration that he was born in the month of Rajab in Medina.
Yes.
He was born in Medina. And as right. When was he born exactly? Or to rephrase the question, how long did he witness Imam Hussein, his grandfather?
Mm-hmm.
Some narrations say that he was 3 years old.
Yes.
On the day of Ashura. Well, I'm sorry. Yeah, on the day of Ashura Imam Hussein died. Other narrations say that he was four. And other narrations say that he was five. So either...
They're close.
Yeah, close. Either 3 or 4 or 5, depending on
But I believe the most famous one is the three-year-old?
Three.
Yes.
Yeah.
Inshallah, we'll get to touch upon, you know, the events that he witnessed. And, you know, what happened in his childhood. But Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam was born under extreme difficult circumstances. I mean, if one was to analyze the time that he was born in, the Umayyad dynasty empowered and utilized all their energies to destroy the mansion of Ahlul Bayt and to destroy the aspect of knowledge. They want an ignorant community, an ignorant ummah. Now, growing up as a child, I know you just mentioned in Karbala, and Hussain alayhi salam, being 3 years old, Imam al-Baqir, the other aspect of childhood. What was the childhood like of Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam? Was it rough? Was it smooth? How was it?
It was very rough.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Imam al-Baqir was born at a period when Muawiyah was in power.
Yes.
Imam al-Hussein was the Imam, but it was a time of taqiyah. It was a time of fear for the Shia. His father, Imam Zain al-Abidin, along with Imam Hussein, they lived in times of fear. 3 years old in Karbala, he witnessed at the age of 3, you're a child. You're not supposed to witness killing and and beheadings and bloodshed and being cursed and being beaten. Imam al-Baqir saw all of this. He witnessed all of this.
Mm-hmm.
He saw the beheading of Imam al-Hussein. He saw all of the events of Karbala. Not only that, but he was taken as captive with the women and children. We tend not to mention this. We only mention that Imam Zain al-Abidin was taken captive, but his son Imam al-Baqir was also with him. This was not easy for Imam al-Baqir to be taken as captive and to see your father, and to see your father in chains,
your
and
sisters.
In al-Jami'ah, which was that painful, you know, that long wood where the neck and the hands of Imam Zain al-Abidin were tied. This was not easy. Being cursed, being beaten with the heads of your grandfather and his companions all in front of you on spears. This was very difficult. After that, in Medina, at the time of Imam Zain al-Abidin, still living under fear, under persecution. As we mentioned yesterday, the Ahlul-Bayt were persecuted. They were cursed on the minbar. This was the upbringing of Imam al-Baqir.
Yes.
With all of that, yet he turned out to be a pious, successful scholar for all Muslims.
Mm-hmm. Now, many state that, you know, because he's an imam, he turned out to be, he's appointed. But normally, as a child, as you mentioned, a child expects comfort, love, you know, the majority of the children that grow up with you know, mental disorders, go back to the way they were nurtured, whether they were abused when they were a child, whether their parents did not, you know, treat them in a proper way.
This did not affect Imam al-Baqir.
This did not affect
although he
witnessed something.
He witnessed trauma.
It's not even tragic. It's beyond tragic.
It's beyond tragic. He went through trauma, but it didn't have an influence on him, subhanAllah. Mm-hmm. And this shows you that you can overcome trauma. You can overcome tragic events.
Mm-hmm.
There are some people, if they go through tragic events during childhood, they let those events affect them into adolescence and adulthood.
Yeah.
But this did not happen with Imam al-Baqir.
Imam
al-Baqir was determined to lead.
Mm-hmm.
Determined to lead the Muslim population, the Shi'i population. And that's exactly what happened.
Mm-hmm. Now, out of the childhood, I mean, you know, a childhood goes from a three-year-old up to, you know, 12, until you're a teenager. That's considered a childhood. People consider teenagers still a childhood
right. In
our communities today. Now, the only thing that is mentioned about Imam al-Baqir is what happens in Karbala. What about after? I mean, up to the age of 12, up to the age of 10, what happened to him?
Right.
History doesn't mention none of this.
Perhaps nothing significant occurred.
Mm-hmm.
You know, historians don't discuss the details because nothing significant occurred. However,
and this needs deep examination to read through history. Right. But before we go into a break, I want to mention something that's nice, and they give credit to al-Baqir alayhi salam. One of the books mentioned that when the captives arrived in Sham, Yazid looked at the women and he said, "The women are to be sold as slaves and the men to be killed."
Mm.
And the only men were who? Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, and that's it. And the little boy, Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. Not a little boy, he's an imam. But yeah, so right away when Imam al-Baqir heard this, he said, "Oh Yazid, at least when Pharaoh captured Moses and his brother Aaron, he asked the nation what to do with them.
Mm.
And you're treating the descendants of the individual who brought religion in this manner." He called them out in front of everybody. This was a three-year-old calling out, you know, the most powerful individual at that time.
Mm.
Now, so we do see his bravery, his courage,
from a young age.
From a very young age. But inshallah, we'll get to touch upon more about the life of Imam al-Baqir before his imamah, but after a short break, if you will, Sayyidina.
Inshallah.
Allah salam. So respected viewers, do stay tuned for after the break for inshallah continue our discussion revolving around the life of Imam al-Baqir prior to his imamah. Respected viewers, once again, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I congratulate you once again on an auspicious occasion, which marks the birth anniversary of our fifth Imam, seventh infallible Imam Muhammad Al-Baqir, peace and blessings be upon him. Now, before the break, we did touch upon a little bit about the life of Imam Al-Baqir, peace be upon him, prior to his imamah. This was discussed with my dear guest, Sayid Hussein Al-Qazwini. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Alaykum as-salam.
Once again, I welcome you to the show.
Thank you very
Allah
much.
Allah salimkum. Now, before the break, we touched upon briefly about his parents, about the events that he witnessed, and we mentioned Karbala. But there was one significant individual that really was so lucky enough, and he's considered as the longest living companion to Prophet Muhammad after, you know, witnessing seven infallibles. Mm. You know, it's incredible. He should be written in a World Guinness. You know what I mean? Because individual meeting, you know, seven, you know, historically known figures, it's something remarkable.
Absolutely.
But as traditionalists tell us, that Prophet Muhammad prophesied to this individual that he will meet the fifth descendant from his
progeny,
being the Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam. Now, we always, it's Jabir Ibn Abdillah Al-Ansari, this individual. We always mention him during Arba'een, the birth or martyrdom of Imam Al-Sajjad, and barely people mention him in the birth and martyrdom of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam. Who was this individual? We only hear of him once or twice a year.
Right.
The rest of the year, nothing about him.
Right.
It's like he's a character that's randomly put in a story which appears once or twice. Who was he? Mm.
Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari was one of the companions of Rasulullah. And he was one of the close companions and loyal companions. Mm-hmm. He was present at Badr. He was there, one of the soldiers mm-hmm. at Badr. He was present with Rasulullah in the most difficult times. He was from Medina. Mm-hmm. He was a native of Medina, hence called Al-Ansari. He was from Al-Ansar. And when we read history, we see that Jabir had some great qualities. Mm-hmm. One of them was that he was very brave. He was outspoken. He was brave. After during the Khilafah of Umar ibn al-Khattab, mm-hmm. the second Khalifa, he banned Zawaj al-Mut'ah, temporary marriage.
Banned it, Jabir?
No, Umar.
Umar banned it.
Umar banned temporary marriage. And that it's a famous story, it's a famous case that he stated, Mut'atani kanata ala ahdi Rasulillah wa ana uharramuhuma.
Wow.
That there were two mut'as that existed during the time of the Prophet, but I banned them and I will punish anyone who performs them.
Wow.
Mut'at al-Hajj, to perform mut'a al-Hajj. Hajj al-Tamattu', which would require a lecture of its own to explain what Hajj al-Tamattu' is. And al-Tamattu' bin-Nisa, mm-hmm. Mut'at al-Nisa, mm-hmm. which is temporary marriage. Mm-hmm. It was banned. Historians say that Jabir ibn Abdullah questioned Umar ibn al-Khattab. And he had, you know, verbal battles with Umar on banning Mut'ah. And he would explicitly, you know, people were in fear.
Yeah.
Khalas, Umar banned Mut'ah. Don't say anything.
That's it.
Jabir spoke out that Umar has banned Mut'ah while Allah in the Quran states it's halal, but Umar ibn al-Khattab says that it's haram. Enough? That was not enough. Jabir ibn Abdullah would go and publicly perform mut'ah at the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab.
Cool.
Publicly, as in, he would announce
it,
that I performed mut'ah marriage. And whatever they want to do, let them come and do.
So why is it secretly now?
That would require a lecture of it.
Yes.
He would announce, he publicly announced that mm-hmm. I am performing mut'ah marriage out of... Of course, he wasn't doing it out of lust.
Oh, definitely.
It wasn't out of
lust. Let's hope not.
It was out of objection. It was a political objection to the Khalifa of his time, and they couldn't do anything to him. Why? Because he's one of the top Sahaba. Mm-hmm. He was in Badr. His position was known to everyone, his position to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is Jabir. It was known. Two, even in Ziyarat al-Arba'een, the Ziyarat al-Arba'een, Imam Hussein was slaughtered, him and his companions. Who would dare at that time? And of course, you know, the Umayyad propaganda had spread the news that this is, that who was killed in Karbala? It was not the grandson of Rasulullah, but they were Khawarij.
Rebellions.
They were a rebellious group of people that were trying to create fitna inside the Ummah. Tayyib. And there were, you know, there was no mass media for people to get their news correctly right away. So for a long time, people really thought that it was Khawarij. Jabir ibn Abdillah, under such circumstances, he comes to Karbala and he visits Imam Hussein. This shows his bravery.
Yeah.
This shows his courage. This shows that not only did he have love for Ahlul Bayt and that he was loyal to them and he was a genuine follower of Ahlul Bayt, but he was, he was making a political statement that although you killed this man, and although I am blind and it is difficult for me to come, I will come.
Wow.
He came to Imam Hussein. He came to Imam Hussein's grave and
the famous story.
Tradition.
Yeah.
He made a tradition. Imagine a man that creates this major tradition.
And the Imam of Ahlul Bayt, Imam Al-Askari, emphasized on that.
He emphasized on it. And he made it one of the
main
signs
of a
believer.
Yeah.
One of the signs of a believer. Subhanallah. A regular human being, a regular individual. When I say regular, he wasn't ma'soom.
He wasn't.
He wasn't infallible. Yet he set this tradition, and every year people, how many millions? 10 million, 50 million
over
people every year they follow the tradition of Jabir ibn Abdullah Al-Ansari, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which reminds us of the hadith by Rasulullah, that man sanna sunnatan hasana, kana lahu ajruha wa ajru man amila biha ila yawm al-qiyamah.
Wow.
That he who sets a tradition, he will have its reward, and he will be rewarded forever. Whoever practices that tradition,
wow.
Whoever sets a tradition, he'll be rewarded. If it's a good tradition, and on the contrary, whoever sets a bad tradition, he will be punished for it, and
whoever,
he will be punished for whoever practices that tradition
until the day of judgment.
Until the day of judgment.
Wow.
Now, Jabir ibn Abdullah, during the life of Rasulullah, Rasulullah had foretold about Imam Al-Baqir. In fact, he named him Imam Al-Baqir. He had mentioned that that my grandson Muhammad Al-Baqir,
yes,
will be born, and he called him Al-Baqir. He called him Al-Baqir. He gave him this title. Now, why did he give him this title? There's several opinions. Some say لَأَنَّهُ يَبْقَرُ الْعَمْ.
Mm-hmm.
He will rip through knowledge, and disperse knowledge, and spread knowledge. Others say no. Al-Baqir comes from يَبْقُرُ الْجَبْهَ. He slit through his forehead. Now who slits through his forehead? Because of sujood, because of his long prostration, he caused damage to his forehead. His skin started to peel, and there were cracks. There were cracks in his forehead from his long sujood. And they could both be right. He was called Al-Baqir maybe for both of these reasons.
Mm-hmm.
But the first reason is more well-known.
Is more famous, yeah.
Is more famous and more well-known. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told Jabir that you will meet my grandson Muhammad ibn Ali. That means he told Jabir that you will live a long life.
Yes.
That you will live through my reign, my prophecy,
mm-hmm,
and my prophethood. And you will live through Ali ibn Abi Talib, Imam al-Hassan, Imam al-Hussein, Imam Zain al-Abidin, up until Imam
Al-Baqir.
Muhammad al-Baqir. This is one of the merits of Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, that he met seven of the ma'sumin.
Wow.
Seven of the infallibles. Rasulullah, Fatima al-Zahra,
Imam Ali,
Ali al-Hassan, al-Hussein, Imam Zain al-Abidin, Imam al-Baqir.
Wow.
This is one of his merits. Of course, I forgot to mention, among his merits, is that Hadith al-Kisa
is narrated? Wow.
Is narrated by Jabir ibn Abdullah Ansari.
Wow.
By whom? He narrates it from whom?
Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam.
And no one else narrated from Fatima al-Zahra.
That's how close he was.
You see, no one else narrated Hadith al-Kisa from Fatima al-Zahra other than Jabir ibn Abdullah Ansari. What does that tell you? That means that he heard it from a public lecture from Fatima Zahra?
Of course not.
Wasn't a public lecture. That means she said it to him privately.
So he didn't witness it. Fatima Zahra neighbor.
He didn't witness. No. An Fatima Zahra, an Jabir ibn Abdillah Al-Ansari. That means he heard it from Fatima Zahra and he narrated it.
Wow.
That means he was a student of Fatima Zahra. Who would sit with Fatima Zahra? Fatima Zahra is known for her hijab.
Yeah.
She didn't have private sessions with men. Jabir ibn Abdillah was an
exception.
Was an exception. He was a private student of Ahlul-Bayt.
Wow.
Including Fatima Zahra alayhi salam. So, you know,
we
always hear about this. We always hear an Fatima Zahra, an Jabir ibn Abdillah Al-Ansari, or an Jabir ibn Abdillah Al-Ansari, an Fatima Zahra. We hear it, but we don't analyze
it.
But this shows that he was a private student of Ahlul-Bayt. He would enter their homes. He was given knowledge that others were not given. طيب. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he told him, you will live enough to witness my grandson, Muhammad ibn Ali, Al-Baqir. And when you do so, give him my salam. Give him my salam. This is a merit for Jabir, and this is a merit for Imam Al-Baqir. One is that Rasulullah trusted Jabir ibn Abdullah with this. With giving us salam.
Yes.
Trusted them. He trusted him with this. Two, Rasulullah is giving his salam to Imam Al-Baqir. Although Jabir ibn Abdullah, he witnessed Imam Al-Hasan, Imam Al-Hussein, Imam Zain al-Abidin, Imam Al-Baqir, Rasulullah gave his salam to Imam Al-Baqir. And as a child, this took place as a child. And he told him, after that, you will die shortly. Once you will see my son, grandson, and Imam Baqir, you will die shortly.
Mm-hmm.
Historians say that that Jabir ibn Abdullah he lost his eyesight.
Yeah,
he was blind. He would sit in the markets, and he would shout, "Ayna Baqir al-Ulum?"
Wow.
Where is Imam al-Baqir? He would shout every day. He would come in the markets, and he would call for Imam al-Baqir. Until one day, according to a hadith, that Imam Al-Baqir, he says, I went to visit Jabir ibn Abdullah as a child.
This is another merit.
This is another merit that an Imam visits him. He went to him. He said, who are you? He couldn't see. He said, I am Muhammad ibn Ali ibn al-Husayn. So he said, بِأَبِي أَنْتَ وَأُمِّي. May my mother and father be a sacrifice for you. إِدْنُ مِنِّي. Come closer to me. فَدَنَوْتُ مِنِّي. I came closer to him. He said, so he grabbed my hands and he started kissing my hands. And then he bent to kiss my feet.
Wow.
I told him no. And then he said, Inna Rasulullah yuqra'uka as-salam.
Wow.
Your grandfather Rasulullah passes on his salam to
decades.
You. Decades after. Decades ago. He says, فَقُلْتُ وَعَلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَعَلَىٰ السَّلَامِ rahmatullahi barakatuh. And may the peace of Allah be upon my grandfather, Rasulullah. He said, but how? How did Rasulullah send me his salam? He said, I was with him one day. And he said, Ya Jabir, la'allaka tabqa. Perhaps you will remain until you will meet a man from my progeny. He is called Muhammad ibn Ali ibn al-Husayn. Allah will grant him light and wisdom. Give him my salam.
Wow.
And another narration, that once you will meet him, you will die shortly afterwards. And in other narrations, that Jabir ibn Abdullah died that same evening.
Wow.
After meeting Imam al-Baqir, and he passed on his salam. خلص بعد. He performed his duty. He passed away.
Some say that his mission was to actually get the salam to Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, inform him. That was his mission too.
Yes.
Wow, and mission accomplished.
This is what, according to one narration. According to another narration, no, that he spent time with Imam al-Baqir.
Yeah.
But during his early days, he was still a child. Once Jabir ibn Abdullah was sitting with Imam al-Baqir. Now this shows Jabir ibn Abdullah's humility and lack of arrogance. He's an old man. He's over 100. He's over 100 years old.
Yeah.
Imam al-Baqir is... He's what?
Still a teenager.
He's 5. He's 6.
Oh wow.
Yeah, he's a child.
Very young.
He's very young. A man who has surpassed 100 is sitting with a child that's no more than 5 or 6, but he's treating him like the other way around, as if he's the child, and the imam is the old man.
Wow.
This shows a lot of humility. Imam Jabir ibn Abdillah tells Imam Baqir, he says, "Ya Baqir, laqad utita al-hukm sabiya."
Wow.
Just like the Quran.
As the Quran says.
The Quran
too.
Speaks about Yahya. And Isa. He says, "Laqad utita al-hukm sabiya." You've been given wisdom at a young age. At a young age.
Mm-hmm.
This was one of the chapters on the life of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam.
Well, I mean, now we really, it's great that you mentioned. I mean, because Jabir ibn Abdillah Al-Ansari, a huge disservice has been done to him, because not a lot of people do talk about him and, you know, explicitly mention what you mentioned right now, the virtues of Jabir. And, you know, we read Hadith Al-Kisa every single Thursday night, Friday Eve, yet we don't even, you know, recall or we don't even recognize that this is Jabir ibn Abdillah Al-Ansari narrating it from who?
From
Zahra alayhi salam. Now lastly, if you can briefly, we did mention about the events that he witnessed, but if you can briefly tell us about other events, for example, like the caliphs, the rulers that ruled during his time,
sure.
Who, you know, he came across and such events.
Sure. First of all, Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, he witnessed Ashura.
Mm-hmm.
And the events that took place after Ashura. He witnessed Waqa'at al-Harra, which was the event that took place 1 year after Ashura,
yes,
in the city of Medina, when Yazid sent his army to Medina and he told them you could do whatever you want. There were many tragic events that took place in Medina. Men were killed, women were violated.
Yeah.
And according to some historians, that so many people of Medina, and who were the people of Medina? Sahaba.
Yeah.
And they say, you the Shia, you violate the Sahaba. Who violated the Sahaba? Who killed the Sahaba? Yazid killed the Sahaba and their children and violated their women. According to some historians, that blood, there were rivers of blood, to the point that the blood reached the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam al-Baqir saw this with his own eyes. He witnessed these events. Imam al-Baqir witnessed the khulafa of, he witnessed, you know, the khulafa, including Muawiyah, of course, the outerly khulafa, the ones who usurped power. Muawiyah, his son Yazid, Muawiyah ibn Yazid, the son of Yazid, Marwan ibn al-Hakam, Abdullah ibn al-Zubayr, who revolted against Bani Umayyah, Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan, Al-Walid ibn Abd al-Malik,
Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, I believe as well.
Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi. Al-Hajjaj wasn't a Khalifa.
He was the governor of Medina.
Kufa.
Kufa, sorry,
The governor of Kufa, of Iraq. Who else? Al-Walid ibn Abd al-Malik, Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, and Yazid ibn Abd al-Malik. And Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik.
Wow.
And it was Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik that sent poison to Imam al-Baqir. So he saw a great deal of Bani Umayyah, of their oppression, of their persecution of the Shia, the persecution of their followers. This was, you know, very difficult times for them.
Very difficult times.
And, you know, we could compare, we could, you know, relate to the times of Imam al-Baqir, during the days of Saddam.
Yeah.
Those who lived in Iraq during the days of Saddam. It was very similar cases. Times of fear, persecution, death, mass murder, mass graveyards that we see today. Very similar times. The days of Saddam and the days of Bani Umayyah, Imam al-Baqir had to witness all of this, but patiently. He stood by the side of his father, Imam Zain al-Abidin, to lead the Ummah until the death of Imam Zain al-Abidin, until he became the Imam himself.
Inshallah, we'll continue the discussion revolving on the knowledge of Al-Baqir alayhi salam and what he had to offer, which really surprised me when I was reading through his biography. But I would like to thank you very much for joining us tonight. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Imam Baqir give you the ability to continue serving Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Respected viewers, thank you very much for tuning in tonight. If you were not able to view this episode or the previous episodes, you can visit our YouTube channel at Imam Hussein 3TV. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.